tomorrow night we're looking forward to seeing one of the greatest outpourings that we've seen in this campaign. I don't know why, but somehow down in my soul, I have tremendous anticipation from the Lord for tomorrow night on Monday night. I hope nobody's going to miss that service. If you have to miss any other night, don't you miss tomorrow night. Then Tuesday night, I'm going to speak on the subject, the Lord willing, Daniel in the lion's den. Chapter, beginning at the 17th verse. And when he was gone forth into the world, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, and that is God. Thou knowest the commandments, do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, and honor thy father and mother. The answer and said unto him, Master, all these have I observed from my youth. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, One thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, give it to the poor, thou shalt have treasure in heaven, come take up the cross, and follow me. And he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. I want you to see in this 10th chapter of Mark, one of the greatest chapters in all the New Testament. Not in all the New Testament is there a greater chapter than this 10th chapter of Mark. And here we find incidents in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ that not only bless our souls, but challenge our life and present the issues of life and death to us as probably no other chapter in all the Bible. In this chapter, we find the Lord Jesus teaching on divorce. Some of you people have come to me night after night and wanted me to preach again on divorce. You can find the teaching of the Lord Jesus on divorce in the 10th chapter of Mark. Then you find the little children coming to the Lord Jesus, and he says, forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. You find that in the 10th chapter of Mark. And then in the 10th chapter of Mark, you also find the Lord Jesus warning against the love of money being the root of all evil. Then you find the blind man, Bartimaeus, coming to Christ in the 10th chapter of Mark. And then we find this incident in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now I want you to get the picture, and I want you to get the background. I want you to see the Sadducees, which are the modernists of their day, and the Pharisees, which are the extreme, fighting, contentious people who are orthodox, and sometimes some fundamentalists are guilty of being Pharisees. I want you to see these two groups of people over in Jerusalem. And they're having a little conference and they're getting together to talk about Jesus. Now they say, we hear that there's a revival going on down yonder somewhere. And we hear that a prophet has been raised up and he calls himself Jesus. And he claims to be God and he claims to be the Messiah. And let's see what sort of a fellow this is. Brother, now let me tell you, when a revival gets to moving, the people in high places begin talking. They can't understand it, and some of them don't want to understand it, and their eyes are blinded by the devil, and they get to talking among themselves, and they get to criticizing, and they get to pointing their fingers, and they begin to condemn, and they begin to harangue, and they begin to talk against that which God is doing. Now that has always taken place in the work of God. Now don't ever forget this, that when the Lord is busy, the devil is also busy. And when God begins to move in the city of Los Angeles, the devil is going to get worse. And the devil is going to tremble, and he's going to start shaking in his boots, and he's going to be on the move. He's going to get some of us to sit back and take it easy and say, well, the revival's on the way. And we're going to quit praying, and we're going to quit holding on to God, and we're going to quit our believing God, and we're going to go into unbelief, and we're going to rest on our laurels, and rest on our past, and a past victory, and are going to forget that the victory has not yet come that we're praying for, and we're going to get spiritual pride, and the devil is going to get in. Now there's another thing the devil's going to do. He's going to get the world stirred up. Why, I've already heard of a group of people that got together yesterday in a certain part of Los Angeles, and they're big businessmen of a certain type of business that a Christian has no business having a part of. And they said, now listen here, everybody across town's talking about this revival. Everybody in Los Angeles is talking about that technique. Now this thing is not good for our business. And one of those men told me that he was against all preachers, and he said that he was against this revival. Well, he runs the bar room downtown, and he says that he's against the revival. And I said, brother, I'm hoping that God is going to send such a great revival that it's going to close your bar room up. That's what I told him. And so the devil is going to attack us from everywhere. But let me tell you, I'm not so concerned about what the devil is going to do through the barroom men and through the outside as I am what the devil's going to do on the inside. Now we Christians are going to have to be on guard. And we Christians are going to have to pray twice as much than we've ever prayed before. And if you've been praying an hour a day, brother, you double it and start praying 2 hours a day. The time has now come for real prayer upon the part of God's people and real faith upon the part of God's people, because we could be on the verge of a great heaven-sent Holy Ghost revival. And I'm asking that we might feel, as the people of God, our tremendous responsibility to pray as we've never prayed before. Now, I don't mean to say you pray. I don't mean to say now lay me down to sleep. I don't mean to say a little routine prayer. I mean get a hold of God. And I mean cry out to the Lord and hold on to God as Jacob held on to God. And he said, I'll not let thee go except thou touch and bless me. And I said to the Lord tonight, as I was riding over in the taxi, I said, oh God, I said, I'm not going to let you go till you send revival to Los Angeles. I said, we're going to hold on, and we're going to wrestle with the angel of the Lord, and we're going to plead God together to shake this old wicked city. Because let me tell you, unless we have revival this time, unless there's a moving of the Spirit in Los Angeles at this time, it may be years till God speaks to this city again like this. And not only is our responsibility for the city of Los Angeles, but our responsibility has now become a national responsibility. And thousands of God's people from coast to coast are rejoicing. And the responsibility of prayer is tremendous. I'm sending out telegrams tomorrow, or I'm asking Armin Gesswein to the Bible schools and Christian colleges across America, asking them to call their people upon their knees to prayer that God might send to us a great moving of the Spirit of God that will sweep thousands of men into the kingdom of God and revive His church. Now listen, we're going to have to guard against something else, and I said this 5 nights straight. We're going to have to guard against self, and we're going to have to guard against the flesh, and we're going to have to put self second, and we're going to have to crucify the flesh until only the Lord Jesus is exalted and glorified and magnified in this campaign. And I've been praying that this publicity will not glorify Billy Graham, will not glorify man, but might glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm asking that we might join hands. Let me tell you something. If God wants me to quit preaching some night, if he wants me to sit down and let somebody else lead this thing, and the Spirit of God moves and he chooses other channels, bless your heart, I'm going to be sitting down. I want the Spirit of God to have his way, because I believe that we could see a great national awakening, unprecedented and unparalleled in this generation. Amen. I call upon you to pray, and I call upon you to believe God and hold on to God. I know that it's hard for you to get in your car and drive from Altadena every night. I know it's hard to get in your car and drive from Pasadena every night. I know that some of you come great distances, but this week, let's give God one more great week, and let's make the devil tremble for 7 more days, and let's stand together and believe God together and come together, and let's see God manifest himself during these next 7 days, and ask God for the Holy Ghost, heaven sent revival that our Atari prayed for and that others have prayed for years, might sweep this country. And then another thing. It may not begin in this campaign. This may be the beginning, but it may be carried somewhere else, and it might break out somewhere where you didn't expect. Now, don't you be disappointed if it doesn't come the way you thought it was going to come. And don't Billy Graham be disappointed if it doesn't come the way he thought it was going to be. But God has his own way and his own time to send the moving of the Spirit of God. But listen, I believe we can have revival in the Church of Jesus Christ anytime the people of God meet God's conditions. And if we're ready to meet God's conditions in confession of sin and in faith and in prayer and in humility, we're going to see the greatest revival in the next few days that Los Angeles has ever seen. Because the promise of God is true. And I'm reading it and I'm believing it out of God's Word. Well, when God gets to moving and the Lord Jesus gets to blessing the people, of course the devil gets mad. And so some of the Pharisees and Sadducees got together. They said, now we've got to investigate this fellow. We've got to find out more about it. And so they said, let's send down a couple spies and see if we can find out more about it. So from Jerusalem, these spies, these two Pharisees, start their way one morning when the sun is coming up over the eastern horizon. They make their way down the long, narrow, crooked country road toward the place where Jesus is teaching. And about mid-morning, when the sun is riding high in the sky, we find these men finding Jesus. And there's a great crowd of people gathered together. And the Lord Jesus is making the blind to see, and the deaf to hear, and the dumb to speak, and the dead to rise, and the lame to walk. And the Lord Jesus is blessing the people and going about doing good and teaching the people and preaching as a man having authority. So the scripture says, and all day long these Pharisees watch, and they listen. They're on the outskirts of the crowd. They pull their robes around them, and they stand on the outside looking and watching and whispering among themselves to see what's going on. And then as the evening shadows begin to gather, and the people melt away back into their villages and towns round about, we find these two Pharisees picking themselves up beside the road, making their way back toward Jerusalem to make their report to the Pharisees in Jerusalem. And as they're walking along, we listen to their conversation. One of them says, how came this man learning? He never went to our colleges and seminaries. And then another says, Why, this man speaks with authority. And then another one says to the other, why, indeed, we have seen strange things today. And one of the strange things that they saw that day was this rich young man coming to Jesus Christ with a spiritual problem. Now, I want you to notice that this young man came to the Lord Jesus Christ with a spiritual hunger. He came to the Lord Jesus Christ with a heart that was hungry, and he came to the Lord Jesus Christ to get an answer for his spiritual problem. And no man ever came to the Lord Jesus Christ to ask a question that didn't get an answer. And no man ever came to Jesus Christ with spiritual hunger but what the Lord Jesus didn't feed him. And listen, if God's people get hungry enough and thirsty enough, the Lord is going to quench our thirst and satisfy our hunger with an outpouring from heaven such as we never dreamed during these days. And the first step to revival is to get thirsty. And I hope that you get so thirsty that your tongue swells up and your throat is parched and dry and you cry out to the Lord and he fills our mouths with the water of life and with the outpour of the Spirit of God such as we never dreamed. It can happen during these days. But I want you to see this young man. I want you to notice him. First of all, I want you to notice he's a young man of tremendous enthusiasm. You know, I don't believe anything has ever really been accomplished without enthusiasm. Somebody came to me one day and said, Billy, you know what your trouble is? You're too enthusiastic. And they said that you walk around in the pulpit too much. And they said you swing your arms too much. And they said that you ought to stand behind the microphone and try to calm yourself a little bit. Brother, let me tell you, if this building were on fire, and everybody in this building was about to perish, and I was standing here and nobody knew the building was on fire but me, I wouldn't say, now ladies and gentlemen, I think it might be better if you try to pick yourself up and get out of the building. No, so I'd be shouting and waving my arms. Let me tell you, this whole world is on fire, and thousands and thousands of people are bound for hell, and it's time somebody is getting excited about it. And it's time somebody is beginning to move and beginning to speak, and it's time somebody is getting enthusiasm to win men to Christ. This young man was a man of tremendous enthusiasm. You know what Napoleon once said? He said that men of imagination rule the world. I don't believe any battles have ever been won. No Iliads have ever been written, and no cathedrals built, and no empires founded without enthusiasm. I like holy, consecrated, spirit-directed enthusiasm. Now, I don't like wildfire, and I don't like fanaticism, but I like enthusiasm for the Lord. I really do. There's a woman in a Methodist church I shouldn't have called the denomination, but anyway, down in Virginia, and it was a big church, and I was preaching, and I gave the invitation, and the pastor had on tails and striped trousers, and he came up to me when I gave the invitation, and a woman came down, and she was crying and making a little commotion. And he said, Brother, don't you think you ought to stop that? I said, no, I said, I'm afraid the Lord will strike me dead. You go stop her. And I want you to know, he never stopped her either. We can go to the football game yesterday and shout our lungs out. Well, I talked to a Christian man today, and he went to the football game yesterday, and he hardly talked today. Brother, he was shouting for some team. I don't know who played, but he was shouting for somebody. And he was enthusiastic for his team. And I'm enthusiastic for the Lord Jesus. And I believe that we ought to have holy, spirit-directed enthusiasm for the Lord Jesus Christ. It's time we Christians are waking up. We've sat down long enough like a bunch of pillows and we've sat like a bunch of stones and closed our mouths long enough, and it's time we get enthusiastic for Jesus Christ. It really is. I'll tell you, I talked to old Harvey Fritz over here this afternoon, and boy, he said, it's wonderful. He said, I'm shouting and praising God. I said, well, there's one boy that's on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, holy enthusiasm. And we need it. And we need to let the town know that God's doing something down here. Get out around the town and tell people what Jesus is doing. Well, this man was a man of enthusiasm. Then notice, secondly, he was a man of courage. Now, Nicodemus was also a ruler of the Jews. And he came to Jesus by night. He was a little scared. He was a little nervous, and he tiptoed around and slipped into Jesus by night. But this rich young ruler in the 10th chapter of Mark came boldly in the daytime before all the crowd to ask Jesus concerning spiritual questions and spiritual matters. And the time has also come, ladies and gentlemen, and for Christians to have some Holy Ghost courage. One of the evidences of the Spirit-filled life in the book of Acts was that they spoke boldly for the Lord. And we need to speak boldly for the Lord in this present time. And right now, this week, I'm asking that every man and woman in this great tent tonight go up and down this city speaking boldly for the Lord Jesus Christ. Ask God for strong courage. Ask Him to help you to gossip Jesus. Over in Acts 8:5, it says they went everywhere preaching Jesus. And that word preaching is the same word that's translated in other places, gossiping. In other words, they went everywhere gossiping Jesus. Gossiping Jesus. Gossiping Jesus. Let's go up and down the streets, in the shop, in the taxi, on the streetcar, gossiping Jesus, until everybody in this city shall know that a revival is on. And they're gossiping the Lord Jesus Christ. I've read in the days of Moody that when Moody went to a city like Edinburgh, or Moody went to a city town, was talking about Jesus. Wouldn't that be great in Los Angeles? I'll tell you, it'd be tremendous if everybody was talking Jesus. I talked to a man the other night, and he's unconverted. And he said that he went to one of the biggest nightclubs in this town out on the strip. And he said he went to three tables in that nightclub, and he said that the conversation at all three tables was about this tent meeting down here, and they were wondering what was going on. And I believe that the Spirit of God has prepared the hearts of many people. And if there was ever an hour that the Spirit of God has prepared the hearts of the people of Los Angeles, it's this present moment. And I believe that you have an open door of conversation about the Lord Jesus that you haven't had in years here in this city. Let's take advantage of it. And let's join hands like a football team, and let's go through the line. God's opened the hole, and let's go through for Jesus. And let's gossip Jesus all over this town. Let's tell the city that the Lord Jesus is on the throne, that He's in the soul-saving business, and that He has the answer to the problems of the city and to the problems of the individual life. There are many hungry hearts today. Then notice something else about this young man. He was a man of ambition. He wasn't interested in just coming to a peak and then just staying there. No, sir, brother, you're either going forward or going backward. You can't stand still in the work of God. And we, in this campaign, have come to a peak. Brother, I'm not satisfied with any peak. The only thing I'm satisfied with is all that God has for us at the present time. That's the reason, again, that we need to pray. I'm ambitious, not for Billy Graham. Bless your heart, I hope you mean it. I mean it from the depths of my soul tonight. I'm ambitious for our blessed Lord Jesus Christ, that His name might be glorified and magnified across this nation of ours. That's the ambition that I have tonight. This young man was a man of ambition. Notice something else. He was a clean young fellow. I like to see a clean young man, clear cut, a light in his eye. I shook hands with Louis Zamborini today. Boy, if there's ever a clean cut young fellow, there it is. Louis Zamborini came to Christ a few nights ago in this campaign, a great track star. You know his record. Clean young man. And I said, thank God for clean young men. Some time ago, a man was dying, a great orator died. And he said on his deathbed, young man, keep your record clean. Some of us have got dirty records. Some of us have got marks. Some of us have dirty records as far as our tongues are concerned. Let me tell you this, we'll never have a revival in Los Angeles until the Spirit of God has control of the tongues of Christian people. We never will. Malice, gossiping, envy, pride, all of these sins must be confessed. And we must ask the Spirit of God to take our tongues. Did you know that in this city, I'm going to tell you something, I haven't said anything against this city since I've been here, except I've called it a wicked city. And the Lord only knows it's a wicked city. But I haven't said anything against God's people here, but I'm going to sort of rebuke you right now. Here it is. Did you know that rumors fly fast and gossip travels first and gains momentum and grows by leaps and bounds with every tongue that it passes from, more than any city I've ever been in. And I believe that one of the sins of the Christians of this city is gossiping about each other. And I believe we need to confess it and get right with God. I believe that with all my soul. And another thing that I believe, I don't think God will send us a revival until we forget our difference. I believe that we can fellowship with anybody around the cross of Christ. I don't care what label he's got. I don't care what denomination he comes from. If the Lord Jesus came and stood on this platform, I don't think he'd ask what council we belong to or what denomination we came from. I think he'd talk to us as believers and rebuke us for our individual sins. And I think tonight is the time that we Christians need to bind our hearts together and ask the Holy Spirit to melt us together as one, and that we might know something of love one for the other, and that our hearts might be bound together by the Holy Ghost. That is my prayer. We need confession of sin. You know, there was a lady came up to my wife last night, and she said, Mrs. Graham said, I have heard that your husband is going to preach on Jesse James tomorrow afternoon. Now, I was preaching this afternoon on the subject, Casey at the Back. And it had already been told this dear woman that I was preaching on Jesse James. Now, that's how the story traveled and grown and changed. By the time it got to her, and she came up and said, I'm a cousin of Jesse James, and I can give him some information. And then let me tell you something else. How the stories fly among the Christians in this city. It got out the other night that this lapel microphone that I use, you see it right here? Well, this microphone right here had been told among a certain group was an electrical contraption that gave me electric power when I talked. Brother, I want electrical power. God only knows. I want power in speaking, but I want Holy Ghost power. I'm not electricity from some contraption like this. But the rumors can certainly fly in this time. And I think that we ought to be on a committee of one tonight, every one of us. So I ask God, when we go home tonight and get on our knees, we ought to ask God to take this little old piece of muscle, look at it. This little old piece of muscle, and nail it to the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that we might know what it means to have our tongues crucified and nailed to the cross. We need it in this day. Then another thing this fellow was, he was a wealthy fellow. He had plenty of money. He'd ride down the street in a convertible yellow Cadillac. He had all kinds of money. Well, you know, when the Spirit of God sends revival, it touches your pocketbook too. Did you know that? I don't mean to give to this meeting. I mean it just touches your pocketbook to give it to God wherever you put your treasures and wherever you put your tithes and offerings. It touches your pocketbook. Why, bless your heart, the most sensitive part of your anatomy is your pocketbook. And some of us will give God anything, but they say, oh Lord, don't you touch my pocketbook, that's my sensitive nerve. And if you touch the pocketbook, we jump like we've been shot. When Porter Barrington said that this afternoon, I yelled amen. When he said this afternoon that if the revival hasn't hit your pocketbook yet, brother, you hadn't been revived. It's going to hit every part of it. Well, this young fellow was a wealthy fellow. But then I want you to notice, first of all, tonight, as we hurry along, this young fellow came to the right person. He came to the Lord Jesus Christ. He came to Jesus to get his answer. You know, today, in this country, we have a lot of hungry people. Did you know that? A lot of hungry people in this city. A lot of people whose hearts are very hungry. In Hollywood right now, there are people in nightclubs that are bored with life. They're tired of life. They're miserable. I went out here the other day as a guest of some friends to one of the movie studios. Oh, that Christ might be glorified to witness for Christ. And as we sat in the restaurant of one of the largest studios in the world, eating our lunch, I looked around and they pointed out one big movie star after another. You know, I'm not saying anything against the movie stars, but I'm saying this, that those people look to be the most miserable people I'd ever seen in the world. They had money, they had popularity, they had everything, but they were miserable. And did you know that on the streets of Los Angeles tonight, there are people walking up and down shouting, and on the outside you'd think they were having the best time in the world, but they're really hungry down in their heart. They have problems that they can't solve. They have burdens that they can't lift. And down underneath it all is a fear, a gnawing fear. Many of them are afraid of death. Many of them are afraid of an atomic war. Many of them are afraid of old age. Many of them are afraid of failure. Many of them are afraid of one thing after another. And the answer to their fear is found only in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have problems today among people that cannot be solved outside of Christ. Some people that are here tonight just like that. We have the problem of sex in this country. I haven't spoken much about that in this campaign, but I want to say a word. That sex is completely out of hand in America. And it has become the great national sin and disgrace. And the problem of sex is eating the heart and core of America out at the present time. And the only answer and the only permanent control is not sex education, but Christ and Christ alone. We'll never solve it except in Christ. Then we have a lot of people in this country who are mixed up intellectually. They're mixed up philosophically. a lot of people out here on the university campus, did you know that I've had a number of letters from university students that have been converted here in this campaign, and they've told us that they've had their intellectual problems settled at the foot of the cross of Christ. And you know, there are a lot of sincere people that are seeking intellectual. They're seeking truth. And they'll never find truth outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'll never forget about Alexander Gregorio. Alexander Gregorio had his PhD degree from the University of Berlin. He had another PhD degree from the University of Pennsylvania. He was one of the greatest anthropologists of all the American nation. He had his MD degree, and he was one of the most scholarly men in the world. And Alexander Gregorio was seeking truth. He was hungry. He was seeking intellectual satisfaction, and he hadn't found it. He studied Buddha. He studied Confucius. He studied Muhammad. He studied the teachings of Christ. But he seemed to find nothing that satisfied until one day. He had a little shoe shine boy, shiny shoes. And he saw this little shoe shine boy seemed to be perfectly content and happy with life. He had a great big smile, and he seemed to enjoy living. And as he was shining his shoes, he said to the shoe shine boy, he said, "Son, what makes you so happy?" And the little fellow looked up and he said, "Jesus makes me happy." And you know, he came back time after time, and that little shoe shine boy won Alexander Gregorio to Jesus Christ because he presented to them reality and the sincerity of the truth that is in Christ, and it satisfied every intellectual doubt that he had. A young fellow came to me the other night, and he said, "I have intellectual problems." I said, "Well, accept the Lord Jesus Christ first, and your problems will flee." And he said, "All right." We got on our knees. He accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior. We got up. I said, "Now, what were your problems?" He said, "Brother," he said, "I have no problems anymore. Jesus has settled them all." Yes, Jesus has the answer to all of our problems. The Lord Jesus Christ has the master key. I don't care what your problem is. Some of you have marital problems tonight. You're not getting along in the home. Jesus has the answer for that if you'll turn your life over to Him. Some of you have fear. Some of you have disappointment. Some have prejudice. Some have failing in business. Some are poverty stricken. Some have financial difficulties. I don't know what your problem is tonight, but I know one thing: the Lord Jesus can solve. You know what I'd like to do? I'd like to call Uncle Joe Stalin up. I'd like to call some of the big men around the world, Mr. Truman and others, up. I'd like to get on a big hookup with these big boys. I'd like to say, "Fellas, quit your squabbling. Quit your fight. I've got the answer. Amen. The answer is the Lord Jesus Christ." Amen. Let me tell you something. We're never going to have world peace till Jesus takes over and declares the peace. Never will, till He's on the throne room. And let me tell you something. You'll never have peace in your storm-tossed life till you let the Lord Jesus come. He's the Prince of Peace. And you know, you'll never have peace with God until Christ takes over and declares the peace. And thanks be unto God, that's exactly what He's done. He's made peace with God for you, and all you have to do is believe it. Don't you think this young man came to the right person? He came to Jesus Christ. Then secondly, I want you to notice he came in the right attitude. Notice how he came. He came running to Jesus Christ. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible says, today is the accepted time. Now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. And not one place in this Bible, I'm warning you tonight, listen to this, not one place in this Bible can you find that you can be saved tomorrow. But by the grace of God and the authority of God's word, I can promise you that if you come and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you can be saved tonight. And you can have Christ in your heart tonight. Notice another thing. This young fellow came in an attitude of sin. He came and fell before Christ. Now you listen to this as you've never listened to anything in your life. You'll never be saved. You'll never walk down the golden streets of heaven until, first of all, you've been convicted by the Holy Spirit of your sin. You've got to know that you're a sinner. A man came to me this afternoon, wanted me to do some personal work with a young woman. I looked at this young woman, and she had on dark glasses. And she was chewing gum and just laughing and smiling and sort of just looking around, you know, like that. I said, no, I won't do personal work with her. And he said, you won't. I said, no. I said, the Spirit of God's never convicted her yet. And I said, no, you ain't trying to go do anything with her. The Spirit of God has to do the job first. And the Spirit of God must convict the man that is a sinner. And no man can ever be drawn to the Lord Jesus and to God the Father except the Spirit draw. And let me tell you, listen, if the Spirit of God is speaking to you tonight, you better come. Because the Spirit doesn't speak every day to you. Harvest time comes only once in a season. Only one season a year. It's harvest time. This is harvest time in Los Angeles. And if you're to ever be saved, if you're to ever to come to Christ, you better come tonight before it's forever too late. Because the Scripture warns that my Spirit shall not always strive with man. And he that hardeneth his neck, being often reproved, shall suddenly be cut off, and that without remedy. Let me tell you something. You know what God said in his word? God said in Hosea 4:17, the most awful verse in the Bible. The most awful verse in the Bible. Listen to this. The Scripture says this. Ephraim is joined to his idols. Let him alone. Ephraim is joined to his sins. Let him alone. And one of these days, God will say, Jim, Bill, Susie, Mary, is so steeped in their sins and so determined to go their own way, let them alone. Let them alone. And brother, if you ever come to that position, God have mercy upon your soul. When God himself leaves you alone, if God the Almighty tonight is speaking to you, you better come to Christ before it's forever too late. Because you can harden your heart so, like Pharaoh did, that when the Spirit of God speaks, you won't be able to hear the Spirit of God in your heart. And if you can hear him speak tonight, you better come. There may be a day when the door of grace will be closed and the door of salvation shut and you can't come. You can't be saved just any time you want to, brother. I'm going to repeat that. I wouldn't have said that 6 weeks ago, but I believe it right now after studying the Word of God. I've spent 6 and 8 hours a day in study since I've been here. One of the things that I've found from the Word of God is this. I do not believe that you can be saved any time you get good ready. You have to be saved when the Spirit of God convicts you and calls you to Jesus. Amen. And if the Spirit of God is speaking to you tonight, brother, you better run down that aisle and make your way to Jesus. And I believe he's speaking to many of you tonight. That's what the Scripture says. This young man came to Jesus in an attitude of sin. Then I want you to notice he asked the question. He said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And you've asked it. Sure you have. Remember that day when the flames were dropping the bomb? Remember that day outshined on Iwo Jima? Remember that day in France when the bullets were flying about and the bombs were bursting? You asked that question. Remember that day when the screeching brakes and the siren of the ambulance sounded and you thought that that had your number on it and it was your last day? Remember when you thought your time had come? Remember? Remember? The Spirit of God spoke to you. You said to yourself, I wonder if I'm going to heaven or hell. I wonder where I stand. A great big strong man a few months ago said, I don't care about God. He got in an automobile crash. While in that automobile, pinned for 3 hours, he kept asking the question, I wonder if I'm going to heaven. I wonder if I'm saved. I'm a church member. I'm a deacon at the church. But if then he had made the statement that he didn't care about being saved and didn't like revivals and didn't care about the work of God, like this sort of thing, then he came to the place of death and he didn't know whether he was saved or not. Brother, you better make sure. You've asked that question. You better make certain. Listen, once you've been in a revival like this, once you've been in an evangelistic campaign like this, and once you've had the message preached to you, it's far worse for you to go out not being saved than if you'd have never come in here. I would pray to God. I would pray to the Lord that if you've heard and rejected and neglected, that you'd have never come in here. Because God says it's far worse to hear and then reject than to have never heard it all. The responsibility is now yours. It's on your hands. Your soul and your blood is upon your own hands tonight. And I warn, and I beg, and I ask, and I plead with you to give your life and your heart to Jesus Christ while the Spirit is speaking before it's too late. Then he got the right answer. The answer is this as we go. The answer is this. Believe, accept, trust, receive Christ as Savior, and thou shalt be saved, the Scripture says. God said that. You don't have to work for salvation. You don't have to join anything. You don't have to pay for anything. All you have to do right where you sit is to receive the Lord Jesus' faith. And every one of you, listen, down in this section, down in this section, out before me, every one of you tonight can know that you're ready to meet God before you move from that seat by receiving Christ and receiving the assurance of salvation right tonight, right where you sit. You say, but what should I do? Just let Jesus come in and take over, that's all. You say, but what do I have to do? Hear me. Hear me. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Tonight, right where you sit, you can settle it right now and know forever that you're ready to meet your God. Let me ask you something else. You might have made a decision before in another meeting. You might have made a decision in this meeting. You might have made a decision in your church. You might be a church member. And yet down in your soul, there's a doubt. Nobody else knows that you're doubting. Nobody else knows that you have that unsettled trouble. But God knows, and you know. Brother, you better settle it. Sister, you better settle it. You better make sure. If I had the slightest doubt that I was going to heaven, I'd never step on that street sinner. I'd take the awful chance of meeting God, not knowing that I was ready to meet.